In June 2008, 28-year-old Andrea and her fiancé Brad were settling into life as a family with their newborn son, Tyler.
We had gotten engaged and we were discussing wedding plans when I found out I was pregnant with Tyler. Being a mom, it's something I've always wanted to be.
She's probably one of the most caring people I've ever met. That's what has attracted me to her.
Andrea's mother, Debbie, lived nearby and helped the couple, which allowed her to continue to work as a teaching assistant.
Her pregnancy was very typical. The morning sickness, the bloating.
She looked very pregnant. I could hardly get my arms around her to give her a hug.
We had definitely talked about having more children, but I wanted to get married first and I wanted Tyler out of diapers.
As Tyler, now an 18-month-old toddler, developed, Andrea and Brad agreed they were not ready for another child. They continued to use contraception, and in November 2009, they decided to use an alternative to the pill.
My birth control pills were making me really sick. We were using condoms whenever we had sex. Shortly after that, I noticed my periods getting less and less, which was usual for me from before I was on the pill.
Brad, something's wrong.
She came back out and said, "Brad, I'm bleeding. Can you come and see what's going on?" It was quite alarming.
Oh my God.
There was mucousy blood. It was kind of thick, some clots. Something I'd never seen before in my entire life.
Are you okay?
My anxiety level jumped through the roof. Very sick feeling in the pit of my stomach. I knew that this had progressed into something more than just a backache.
Let's go.
You know, we couldn't wait for her mom to show up. We needed to get some emergency help. So we called 911.
911 center.
I need an ambulance.
What's going on?
The pain was so severe it would take my breath away. So I couldn't talk.
Okay.
She's having severe abdominal pain, but she's kind of bleeding. She's about to pass out, I think.
Okay, is she still conscious right now?
Yep.
She is still breathing, right?
Yep, she's standing up. She's just in a lot of pain. And she said she feels like she needs to push something out.
Okay. Is she bleeding right now?
Yeah, baby, what? Can you talk or no? I may be passing the phone back and forth.
Okay. Hello? Hello?
Yeah.
Okay, are you having any bleeding? Is that what's going on?
Yeah, I feel like I need to go to the bathroom. I feel like I need to poop. And I was sitting on the toilet and I'm bleeding.
Is it constant pain or?
Yeah.
I already have everybody started.
Yeah, she's struggling again.
Is it like a constant pain or what?
Is it a constant pain, baby?
No, it
kind of comes in. She thought it was back spasms like 45 minutes, an hour ago, and then it just progressively gotten really worse in the last hour.
Moments later, Andrea's worried mother entered the driveway, unaware that her daughter had called for an ambulance.
I happened to hear a siren. I was scared, nervous, and I'm just sitting there going, what is going on? What is happening to my daughter?
When we approached the door, it was just obvious she was in a lot of pain. We had her sit down on our stretcher, and we immediately moved over to the ambulance. The amount of pain she was in and the amount of blood that I was seeing, my initial concern was that she was, in fact, having a miscarriage.
Do you feel anything?
But as I was examining her abdomen, there was really nothing that seemed to indicate pregnancy. But the types of things that could cause bleeding can also be life-threatening, so we needed to start heading for the hospital.
We've got to go. Priority one.
Her mother followed the ambulance on the 20-minute drive to the hospital, while Brad stayed behind with Tyler.
I get in my car and I'm trying to follow them. I was getting very nervous, kind of freaking out, going, what's going on with my daughter?
It's okay.
On a scale of 1 to 10, the pain was probably about a 15 to 20. Every time I would have a back spasm, I felt like something needs to come out. And she said, well, next time you have one, go ahead and push and we'll see what's going on.
We'll find out what's going on, all right?
I felt another one. And she said, okay, go ahead and push. And she looked, and she at that point said that she saw a bunch of blood and mucus.
I was very concerned. In the process of looking to see how much bleeding there was, she started to have a lot of pain again, another huge cramp. That's when we noticed that she was crowning. The head was visible.
Andrea wasn't having a miscarriage as they feared. She was about to give birth.
I looked right at her. I said, Andrea, you're about to deliver a baby. And she just really kind of looked at me like she didn't believe what I had just said.
I was in total and utter shock. That's when I realized, you know, that I was in labor.
The ambulance was still 10 minutes away from the hospital when the paramedics realized they wouldn't get there in time. They faced the inevitable, that Andrea would have to deliver her baby in the ambulance.
I was gonna need help. So I asked my partner to pull over and come to the back of the ambulance.
And all of a sudden, the ambulance just pulls over to the side. The EMT got out. They are both in the back. My heart was in my throat. I'm like, is she okay? What is going on?
I was concerned because there were just so many things that were coming to mind that could be going wrong.
Andrea's mother, Debbie, pulled over to the side of the road behind the ambulance, unaware of what was going on inside.
I was scared. I was crying. I wanted to get into the ambulance and see, but I kind of froze.
Within a minute or two, Andrea was having another contraction, and that time I saw a lot more of the head, and I saw a little bit of the cord, and you generally don't want to see the cord before the head comes all the way out.
What's wrong?
Cord prolapse is a condition where the cord prolapses or falls through the cervix ahead of the baby's body or head. This is an obstetric emergency because the cord can get compressed against the head or the body part and can cut off the blood supply to the baby.
I was shaking. The main thing that was going through my head was that I was basically going to be giving birth to a baby that wasn't not alive. It was quite excruciating. Just knowing that I was basically in a car and not in a hospital having all this happen.
Push.
It was quite painful.
Very quickly, the baby's entire head was out.
All right, it's coming out right now. Couple more pushes, ready?
And then, like a second after that, the rest of the body's delivered.
All right, it's out.
You got it.
The baby instantly started to cry. And then it hit me that he was alive. And the only thing that was coming out of my mouth is he okay? Is he okay?
I clamped the cord. And then I cut the cord.
Just cutting the cord right now.
Okay.
I suctioned the baby's mouth, then his nose, and then I started drying him off. Newborn babies need to be kept warm. They're used to a very warm environment, and now he's all of a sudden out in my ambulance.
The paramedic had him in a warming blanket and was rubbing on him and trying to warm him up. He said he was just very cold and we needed to get him to the hospital.
Let's get moving.
All of a sudden, one of the paramedics comes out of the back of the truck and looks at me.
It's a boy!
And yells out, it's a boy! And I went, what?
What are you talking about?
It's impossible. What are you talking about?
Debbie immediately called Brad, who was at home with their 2-year-old son.
Hello.
I'm sitting on my couch still trying to figure out what's going on. You know, I'm still scared.
And I was sitting there going, Brad, guess what? You're a father.
What?
You've got another son.
It was definitely one of the biggest shocks of my life, to say the least. There was no indications to me that that she was pregnant.
My God.
We got dressed and we went down to the hospital.
I'm on my way.